This screencast will discuss the bisection method. We wish to find the zeros of this function. So to begin, I've plotted the function as a function of x between 0 and 4. We see that we have a 0 somewhere between 1 and 1.5, and we also have another 0 somewhere between 2.5 and 3. For this demonstration, we're just going to focus on the 0 between x equals 0 and x equals 2. So let's zoom in to that region. Now, the bisection method, you first start out with your bounds. You always have a low bound and an upper bound. The first step of the bisection method is to evaluate the function at the two bounds. F of 0 is negative 1. F of 2 is 0.82. Now we can check. This is very important because in bisection you want there to be a 0 somewhere in this interval. Because f of 0, which is our left bound, is negative, the sine of the function at our right boundary is positive. If this is a continuous function, that means that somewhere the function must equal 0. So we're on the right track. The next step is to evaluate the function at the midpoint of the current bounds. So that's why it's called the bisection method. We're basically bisecting our current interval, 0 to 2, and that's at x equals 1 at the midpoint. We see that the function at an x value of 1 is negative 0.16. Really, the only important thing is the sine. It's negative. So where must there be a 0? Because the function is negative at 0, it's negative at 1, and it's positive at 2, we know somewhere between 1 and 2, there's a sine change. And when there's a sine change, that means there's a 0. In the bisection method, you just eliminate half of all the x values in that current interval. We know that there can't be a 0 between 0 and 1 because the sines of both those functions are negative. Let's go to the next step. So we take our previous remaining interval. So we're zooming in on that x-axis. Our new bounds are 1 to 2. The next step is to evaluate the function at those two bounds. We then bisect our interval and determine the function at the midpoint. So the midpoint between 1 and 2 is 1.5. We see that it has a positive sign. So where must the 0 be? It's got to be somewhere between 1 and 1.5 because that's where we see the sign change. Because of this, we can eliminate the 1.5 to 2, and we can eliminate half of our choices. Now we're going to zoom in between 1 and 1.5. Our new bounds, 1, 1.5. We calculate the function at 1, the function at 1.5. We see we have a negative sign on the left, positive sign on the right. That's good. That's what we want. There's a 0 because we have a sign change. We then evaluate the function at the midpoint. So f of 1.25 has a positive sign. So where must the 0 be? It's got to be between 1 and 1.25. And we can keep going and doing this process. Basically, every step we're eliminating half of the possibilities. We're zooming in and in. We can easily implement this in Excel. So I've just set up a template here for the bisection method. We can start with our low and our high bounds of our first interval. The midpoint is just going to be the average of the low and high. We want to calculate the function of the low, x times sine of x minus 1. I can copy that formula into the calculate the function at the midpoint and at the upper bound. Because it's relative referencing, I can just paste. Now this is the tricky part, because we want to set it up so we don't have to do this manually. We know that the 0 has to lie somewhere between 1 and 2 because we see a sign change of that function. But what I want to do is set it up so it can do this automatically. Excel has a nice if logical function. So I'm going to say if. I'm going to ask the question, if the function at the low, our left bound, multiplied by the function at the middle, if that's a positive value, that means it does not cross the x-axis. There's no 0. So if the function at the low multiplied by the function at the midpoint is negative, That means that somewhere in that interval between 0 and 1, there has to be a 0. If that's the case, we want to maintain an x value of the low bound. Otherwise, we want to redefine the low as the middle. Similarly, to redefine the high bound, I can use the if. So if the low function times the midpoint is less than 0, which it is in this case, then we want to redefine the high point as the middle. Otherwise, we want to keep it as the current high bound. Now, I'm just going to copy this formula for the midpoint down. We should have 1.5. And I can also copy these formulas down. In the first iteration, we know that we're going to be between 1 and 2. And what did it do automatically? It redefined the high and low as 2 and 1. If I copy all these down to the next row, we should be redefining the low as 1 and the high as 1.5. And that's what, in fact, it did. And we see that our function value is rapidly approaching 0. We're zooming into an x value for the solution, the 0, or of about 1.115 or so. If I really wanted to, I could bring this down. We get very, very close to a solution of about 1.114. So let me just summarize what's happening here. So in the first iteration, we basically eliminated half of our interval. In the second, we eliminate another half. And we keep going. We bisect each interval and we remove half. And then finally, we're down to a small enough step that we're basically zeroing in on where the function goes from negative to positive. And at that point, we're essentially bounding the 0, and we have gotten to our solution. So one iteration, we eliminate 50%. Two iterations, we've eliminated 75, 3, 87.5, and we can keep going and going. After 10 iterations, we've eliminated 99.9% of the possible x's, so our error is very small. So bisection method, even in 10 iterations, you get a very, very good approximation. Add on another 10 iterations, and you're down to, you know, one part per million.